How does that fit onto this chart we've been talking about of all the different worldviews? Well, you notice we have the Christian worldview, and then we're talking right now about the secular humanist worldview. You look at that and realize, well, in theology, secular humanism is the philosophy of, or is the idea of atheism. Ism is a belief. Theos means God. Ah means no or not. So atheists can be one of two kinds of people. They can be people who believe that no God exists, or they can be people who believe that no God belief is relevant, except the belief that God belief is irrelevant, right? Of course. But that's the basic idea. That's atheism. In philosophy, the term there you see in the chart is naturalism. Naturalism. Naturalism is an expression that relates to how things came about. Naturalism says everything that exists came about through natural processes. It's not that the naturalist can prove this, it's that the naturalist makes this the underlying assumption for developing the rest of philosophy. So you'll find people who say, we are naturalists at our core. Which means we start with the assumption that everything that exists came about through natural processes. There wasn't a special creation. There's no supernatural existence. Now think about this for a minute. Somebody who believes that nature is all that exists, and you believe that there's something outside of nature, how do they process that? If only nature exists, how do you explain God belief? Sigmund Freud tackled this. And even though he's now out of favor in most quarters, his basic core argument here is still widely believed. He said, human beings believe in God because they want there to be something bigger than themselves. That God belief is actually a projection of an idealized father image. Paul Vitz made an interesting argument in a book called Faith of the Fatherless. Faith of the Fatherless. He said, you know, it's interesting that secularists never actually prove that the idea of God is a projection of our desire for an idealized father image. He said all the people who came up with that just so oddly seem to have bad relationships with their fathers. Maybe atheism is their projection of an idealized no father image. Right? Their idea is because we had bad relationships with our fathers, we want to destroy the idea that there is any great father in heaven. So how would you decide which one of those is true? There's got to be something besides just the argument itself. The secularist starts with the idea of naturalism. All right, in ethics, moral relativism. The ethicist from a secular humanist standpoint is going to say ethics is either relative to the person. Not very many of them will actually say that because that would lead to anarchy, wouldn't it? But they might say, actually, instead, ethics is relative to a person's culture. That one culture would have a different set of ethical norms, and that would be okay because that's the way it evolved for that culture. Let's see, where are we? In biology, neo-Darwinian evolution. The original idea of evolution was that species, through changes in their environment, actually, so the certain ones survive, the other ones do not, and there's kind of a selection process that goes on. Later on, people added the idea of mutations, that there are changes in the genetic structure and that those changes might be productive given enough replications, and that you would actually see changes from one species to another. Other theories of evolution have come along since that time. One of them is genetic drift. Another one is called punctuated equilibrium, which talks about the abrupt appearance of species. So these are the different ideas out there. But the secular humanist is going to prefer these, any idea that doesn't rely on a special creator. Because if there is a creator, that means there's a God, and all of a sudden the idea that God is irrelevant to life doesn't make any sense anymore because it's at least relevant to figuring out where we came from and how we got here. In psychology, monism. We've talked about this before as well. Ism is a belief. Mon means one. So human beings are of one substance, and that substance is the body. We have bodies. We do not have souls. We do not have spirits. So why do we believe we have souls? A soul, according to the secular worldview, is an epiphenomenon. It's like a movie that the brain shows onto life, convincing us that we actually have minds that are separate from our brain activity. It's interesting now how many people are actually secularists who are contradicting the idea of naturalism and materialism. In fact, one of them, Thomas Nagel, is a well-known philosopher from New York University, recently wrote a book called Mind and Cosmos. And in the book he said, all of the arguments for materialism fail. He said, that doesn't mean I believe in an immaterial reality, but I can't believe that only the material world exists because none of the arguments are philosophically plausible. This is one of the top philosophers in the world saying this. Brain scientists have come out and said this. One guy I've read about is read his two books. One's called The Spiritual Brain, and the other one is called Brain Wars. He's a professor called Maurice Beauregard. And he gives a lot of really interesting, compelling arguments that the idea that only bodies exist can't explain the existence that we actually know we have. But anyway, that's where secular humanism lies. That's where they are. Sociology, non-traditional family, church, and state. In other words, the institutions of society are made up by people. And if we don't like them anymore, we can change them. Who would change them? Whoever is in power. They can just do that. What about law? This is what's called positive law, legal positivism. After World War II, I mentioned, people had to come up with a theory for how to try the Nazis for war crimes. The Nazis did things that were so evil, we didn't even have categories of laws to talk about them. Nobody imagined that anybody would ever do evil things like that. So how do you prosecute these people? Well, you have to develop a body of international law. Well, is that right to develop a body of law after the fact and turn around and take that law and put it back onto people who did things before that law was developed? So the lawyers went back and looked at the international laws that were available, but ultimately they had to come down on one of two sides. Either they had to come down and say, we know that what the Nazis did was wrong because we know that. Every human being knows that it was wrong because there is a natural law that is true across all cultures and all times for all people, and the Nazis knew it and they should have obeyed it and they didn't. The other group, the legal positivists, said law is what the human beings in charge decide. So we are in charge now and we will decide. Problem is, that sets a really bad precedent, doesn't it? Because it means that human beings become the law. If people get into power and decide, they don't need other people to tell them what to do, then who's to say that what they're doing is actually wrong? This is why the American founders were so intent on saying, the government does not give rights to people, it only secures rights that were given to them by God. Politics, liberalism, you might put another word there, we use it a little bit later, interventionism. The idea to the secular humanist is we can perfect people, but in order to do this, we have to use the government. We have to use institutions. The family can't do it. Church can't do it. Church is bad because they believe in a God that doesn't even exist. So the government's going to have to do this. The government will tell people what is right, the government will tell people what is wrong, and it will tell them what they ought not do. So we'll establish it through law. Problem with law as the basis for reality is that it can never lead you to right action when you really think about it. I mean, I have some friends who recently have taken on a foster child in their home. And one of the foster care regulations in the state of Colorado, and I can hardly even say this without getting choked up. One of the laws says that you may not feed the foster child out of a dog bowl. And I heard that and I just thought, who would ever do that? I mean, who would ever say to a foster child, you're no better than a dog, eat out of the dog's bowl? What a cruel, evil thing to do. And yet somebody must have done it because they had to put the law on the books. So the law is, you can't make a child eat out of a dog bowl, but the law can't say you must love the child. That's not something that is covered in the domain of the law. So law is really limited into how it can bring about change in a society. In economics, interventionism is the key idea. Interventionism says the economy will go off the rails if you just let people have free exchanges. So the government has to get involved and tell people what to do and what not to do. There are different levels of this law. Some people say the government is like an arresting officer. It stops people from doing things that the government does not want them to do because the government's decided those things are bad. Other people, more free market people, would say the government needs to exist, but more as a traffic cop, right? To make sure that the traffic flows smoothly, not to stop the flow of traffic. And then finally, you have history, which is the idea of historical evolution. So the story of history I gave you earlier, this is the way history is. The Enlightenment solved all of our problems. We're now going to be awesome, and we're going to continue to evolve into the future. Some secular humanists, not all, but some secular humanists actually believe that now that we are smart, we can take charge of our own evolution, which means that the elites, the ones in power, can tell everybody else how we're going to evolve into the future. So history is often used as an argument to try to justify a certain course of action rather than a story about various facts and what happened in the past accurately understood. All right, that was a mouthful, right? But does it make sense a little bit now? If you understand the underlying assumptions of secular humanism, you can see how secular humanists would arrive at this story. One thing I want to point out to you, and we'll talk about this when we talk about each of the non-Christian worldviews, is I will never make the claim to you that nothing secular humanists say is true. Secular humanists have identified certain truths. They have identified certain things that they embrace and believe and understand that we actually know to be so. The question is that the bigger story of the world as it actually exists? Right? A test of reality is not just whether something is logically so. A test of reality is whether or not it explains the victories and disappointments that we experience in everyday life. The question is not whether the secular humanists have identified any truth or not. The question is whether they're telling the whole truth, the whole story, the robust story of the world, as we discovered in the Christian worldview. So recently I had the opportunity to read a book by an author named Ed Catmull. Ed Catmull is the president and co-founder of Pixar Studios, which you all know about. They have produced some of the top films of all time. In fact, in the top 50 films of all time, I think all of their films are in the top 50 films of all time as far as worldwide gross box office receipts. It's been a phenomenally successful company. One of the films made by Pixar Studios is a film called Up. And in the story of Up, a man distraught over the death of his wife fills up 10 to 20,000 helium balloons and launches his home into the sky so that he can take their long-anticipated trip to South America. Unbeknownst to him, trapped on his front porch, is a little boy named Russell, who is a scout trying to earn a merit badge for serving the elderly. And he happens to be on the porch trying to get Mr. Fredrickson's attention when the house takes off. So now they're on a South American adventure. I know this is going to sound cruel, but I'm going to play for you the 4-minute clip that sets up the entire story. I know. I have never been able to watch this clip without tears. But in the clip, we hear in 4 minutes with no dialogue, we learn the entire story of Carl Fredrickson's lifelong love and marriage to his wife, Ellie. And that story sets up the whole rest of the story, and it sets up the example that I'm going to give you in a few minutes about whether we're paying attention to God's bigger story. So here we go. Yeah. I don't know of a film that is more emotionally rich and psychologically complex and deals so searchingly with our deepest longings, our deepest fears, our deepest loves, our deepest losses. In an animated film. But Ed Catmull tells a fascinating story in his book, Creativity, Inc. He says the original script they were handed for the movie Up told the story of a king who had a castle suspended in the air. He had two sons who quarreled with one another over who would have the right to the throne. And through the course of their quarreling, they were cast to earth, where they were helped to understand one another by a tall bird. As you now know, there were two elements that survived that original script, the title, Up, and the tall bird. Think about what kind of film Up would have been if that original story had been produced all the way through to the movie stage. The director might have gotten his way, but he would have produced a story that would never have gotten the box office power that the movie Up had. It would never have produced a story that touched you and me as deeply as we were touched in 4 minutes just now. In fact, the director of the film, Pete Docter, said when faced with the original script, he had to go back and ask the question, what is the bigger, the deeper story that needs to be told here? Secularism is one of those worldviews that tells a story of the world. But I wonder if it tells a story of the world that doesn't really account for what's really, truly important. Maybe the most important question we need to be asking is not how do we tell the story we want to tell about our experience in the world, But how do we allow God to tell His bigger story through us? Does that make sense to you? So the secular worldview, I think, again, is not one that we would say is completely devoid of truth. It just doesn't tell the whole story, is what I would say.